The Grand Canyon is a mysterious place. What secrets does it hold? Shockwaves from recent scientific discoveries have reverberated around the globe, but they have also generated more questions than answers. Could this amazing site be hiding some terrifying truths from all of us? We want you to be a part of the reveal of the shocking results and the resolution of the mysteries that have scientists and the globe on edge. Where does that mystery lie? Where do these forces come from? Furthermore, what does this portend for our future? Researchers have found that the Grand Canyon is missing rocks that should have been there for over a billion years. For decades, this phenomenon has served as a source of concern for the scientific community. They made the discovery after noticing that rocks with ages ranging from 1.4 to 1.8 billion years were found next to rocks with ages ranging from 520 million years. What did researchers find when they excavated the Grand Canyon? What sort of things were found inside the Grand Canyon? The technique of thermochronology was utilized by researchers in order to determine what happened to the Grand Canyon's missing boulders. They employed a variety of different chemical analysis techniques in order to determine the amount of heat that was stored in a rock when it was heated. The findings of this study point to the possibility that certain event or events were responsible for the peculiar gap in the geological record. It was hypothesized that this occurrence took place about the same time as the supercontinent Rodinia disintegrated in a violent manner. Geologically speaking, the eastern half of the Grand Canyon went through distinct transitions than the western half of the canyon did. In the Grand Canyon, scientists have discovered evidence that prehistoric reptiles once roamed the region. What exactly did Alan Krill discover while he was exploring the Grand Canyon? Alan Krill came across a pebble that had a pattern on it that resembled footprints. He snapped several photographs and then emailed them to Stephen Rowland, who examined them and determined that the objects in question were the fossilized remains of once living organisms. Rowland had theorized that the fossil track could be 313 million years old and could have originated from an amniotic, which is an animal that lays eggs with hard shells. Amniotes are known to have existed approximately 313 million years ago. The separation of the footprint from the mana catcher allowed it to remain in relatively excellent condition. The age of the footprints, which were found on a rock, was determined to be 330 million years old after researchers observed two separate imprints. Rowland spotted two different species of reptiles moving diagonally across the field. In addition to this, he observed that one of the reptiles was roughly a foot long and moved in a manner that is referred to as lateral sequence. This is a highly significant finding because it demonstrates that the lateral sequence gait was utilized way back when vertebrates were just getting their start in the animal kingdom. The research that Rowland did on the footprints may have been met with some opposition. Nevertheless, the caverns in the Grand Canyon are full of sloth feces and mummified bats, and sloths, birds, wood rats, mountain goats, and bats have all lived there at one time or another. In a canyon in Colorado, researchers discover fossilized feces from the extinct Chester sloth. Scientists investigating a canyon in Colorado made a remarkable archaeological discovery. Coprolites, or petrified excrement, of the extinct Chester sloth have been discovered deep within the layers of time. Light on Earth's past and the precarious balance of its ecosystems is provided by this finding, which reveals important information on the behavior, diet, and ecological relevance of this ancient creature. The petrified feces provide interesting information about the nutrition of the extinct Chester sloth. Scientists may identify the types of plants and vegetation that were consumed by these animals by analyzing the coprolites and the microfossils contained inside them. The importance of sloths in seed dispersal and landscape formation is highlighted by these findings, which aid in the reconstruction of prehistoric ecology. The Chester ground sloth, which weighed up to 500 pounds and had been extinct for more than 10,000 years, was discovered to have inhabited a rampart cave in the canyon by the team of researchers. Radiocarbon dating was used to analyze the feces, which revealed both the diet of the animal and the types of plants that were native to the area. Because of dams and other man-made conditions, the Colorado River is on the verge of running dry. People are conducting research into the past of the Grand Canyon as a result of a recent discovery. The Colorado River is on the verge of drying up, and the Grand Canyon condors once fed on creatures that are no longer around to provide food for them. This could have led to the bird's extinction. The Colorado River begins its journey in the Rocky Mountains and makes its way through canyons, deserts, and waterfalls on its route to the Grand Canyon. After passing through the Grand Canyon, the Colorado River eventually empties into the Gulf of California. Researchers have discovered that if certain measures are not implemented, the river will run dry in a relatively short amount of time. The construction of dams and changes in the Colorado River's course are two human activities that environmentalists believe have degraded the river's quality of life. The flow of the river through the Grand Canyon is as strong as ever, although the current water level is far lower than it was in the past. Environmentalists believe that dams and the redirection of rivers are the primary causes of this, so individuals interested in going whitewater rafting in the Grand Canyon should do so as soon as possible. According to the opinions of various specialists, uranium mining in the Grand Canyon can be hazardous to people. The poisoning of water supplies as a result of uranium mining is another concern brought up by authorities. The mining and processing of uranium ores both require the employment of chemicals, which, in the event that they are not managed correctly, have the potential to contaminate both groundwater and surface water supplies. Both human beings and other forms of life that are dependent on these water sources are put in grave danger by the presence of contaminants in the water. It is impossible to overstate the potential adverse long-term impact that uranium mining could have on the sensitive ecosystems found within and all around the Grand Canyon. It is true that the Grand Canyon contains uranium, but the level of radiation there is quite low, so it is perfectly fine for anyone to go there. However, there are abandoned mines in the Grand Canyon that present a risk to the people who choose to make their homes there. When the uranium rush began again, people headed back to the Grand Canyon region to begin mining once more. However, for the previous 20 years, uranium mining has been prohibited on 1 million acres of land surrounding the Grand Canyon. Grand Canyon's Havasupai people were removed from their land against their will. People who have lived in the area now known as the Havasupai tribe have called the Grand Canyon home for a very long time. They inhabit a broad region that may be found to the east of the Bill Williams mountain range and all the way down to the tiny Colorado River. On the Colorado Plateau, to the east of the Moencopie Wash, and quite a distance from the Grand Canyon, was where the Supai people lived. They met European explorers in the late 1800s when they arrived at the canyon and followed the road formed by the Hopi Havasupai and ancient Puebloans. Prior to that time, they were the only people in the area. The Havasupai were relocated to a reservation in Havasu Canyon that included a total area of 518 acres before being ordered to leave by the National Park Service. In 1975, the federal government granted the Supai tribe ownership of 185,000 acres of land within the canyon, as well as along the rim of the canyon. The members of the tribe today make their living through farming, tourism, and paid jobs. The Ruins Museum in Tucson displays artifacts from a town that dates back 12,000 years in Arizona. The Tucson ruins may be a distance of 3 miles to the west of Desert View Point, which is the location of the Grand Canyon's most eastern entrance. The museum and the ruins themselves are the two components that make up the whole. Visitors are able to gain a deeper understanding of the historical site by perusing the various displays that are located close to the ruins of the old village. More than 12,000 years have passed since people first settled in the area, now known as the Grand Canyon, and the archaeological work housed in the Tucson Ruins Museum is the most comprehensive of its kind in the region. Ichneotherium is a type of footprint that scientists believe was left behind by a mysterious group of extinct tetrapods known as diadectomorphs. The diadectomorphs were an ancient group of tetrapods that shared traits with both amphibians and reptiles. They came from the time before the dinosaurs. In the field of vertebrate paleontology, important and unsolved problems concerning the evolutionary relationships of diadectomorphs, as well as their paleobiology, have persisted for a very long time. Even while it's possible that the animal that left the footprints in the Grand Canyon may never be identified with absolute certainty, the trackways in the Grand Canyon preserve the journey of an extremely ancient terrestrial vertebrate. A prehistoric animal with short legs and a big body is suggested by the quantifiable properties of the tracks and trackways. The creature walked using all four of its legs, and each foot had five fingers that did not have claws. The geological formation in which the newly discovered fossil tracks in the Grand Canyon were preserved is another noteworthy component of these traces. The Coconino Sandstone is an Aeolian rock formation that displays crossbedding and other sedimentary features that indicate it was deposited in a desert or dune environment. These features indicate that the Coconino Sandstone was formed. Because of this, the discovery of ichneotherium in the Coconino Sandstone represents the earliest evidence of diadectomorphs inhabiting a dry and arid environment. The Mogollon monster that was spotted in the Grand Canyon, the peculiar characteristics of the creature. A mysterious creature known as the Mogollon monster has been reported in the area surrounding the Grand Canyon. The first sighting of the monster was made in 1903 by a man named I.W. Stevens. He described the creature as having a long white beard and white hair on its head. It is stated that the Mogollon monster stands 7 feet tall, has hair that can be either black or reddish in color, and does not have a face, chest, feet, or hands. It is said that the Mogollon monster is capable of producing terrifying vocalizations, which is one of the most distinguishing features of this legendary creature. It has been reported by witnesses that they have heard eerie howls, growls, and guttural cries that echo through the canyon walls. These sounds are said to generate a sense of fear and anxiety in those who come into contact with them. Those who have heard these sounds have described them as sounding like a combination of human screams and the roars of more primitive beasts. The legends and myths concerning the Mogollon monster have been passed down through the generations by the native people who once inhabited the Southwest, most notably the Apache and Navajo tribes. The recent finding of the canyon cataclysm fault in the Grand Canyon has caused an outpouring of fear and anxiety all across the world. We hope this film has astounded you all, and these discoveries will undoubtedly keep you in shock. If you found this video entertaining, make sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel so you don't miss any of our future videos. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.